Good morning. Today our subject is about the knee joint. We will take two lectures to study the knee joint. Let's begin with knee joint number one, lecture one. We are going to study in these two lectures the type, the articular surfaces, the fibrous capsule, the accessory ligaments, the synovial membrane reflections, the Berzi, the relations, nerve supply, blood supply, movements, and stability of the knee joint. We will also be able to criticize the importance of the anterior and posterior cruciate ligaments of the knee on going downstairs. Moreover, we will compare between the liability of medial and lateral menisci of the knee joint to injury during sudden rotatory movements. First of all, what is the type of the knee joint? The knee joint is a compound bicondylar synovial joint, which is a modified hinge. It's formed of two femoro-tibial joints and a femoro-patellar joint. So we have two femoro-tibial joints and a femoro-patellar joint, which means I have a joint between the femoral condyle and the tibial condyle. And also I have a joint between the patella and the femur. If you look at this picture, we can see the lateral condyle of the femur from the front and the lateral condyle of the femur from the back view. Also, we can see the medial condyle of the femur front view and back view. If we look at this picture, we can see the femoral condyle, lateral and medial, and we can see the two tibial condyles. So we have a joint between the femoral and the tibial condyles. Also, we have a joint between the patella and the femur. So if we look in this other picture, we also see the femoral condyles, the tibial condyles, and there are two joints between the femoral and tibial condyles. Also, there is a joint between the patella and the femur. So the knee joint is a compound bicondylar synovial joint. Articular surfaces of the knee joint. We have articular surface of the femur, articular surface of the patella, and articular surface of the tibia. First, articular surface of the femur. It is an inverted V-shaped, which lies on the medial and lateral condyles. Anteriorly, it is large on the lateral condyle, and it is called the patellar surface. Why is it called patellar surface? Because it articulates with patella. So here is the patellar surface. Inferiorly and posteriorly, it articulates with the corresponding tibial condyles. If you look at this picture, we see the inferior and posterior articular surface on the femoral condyles to articulate with the two tibial condyles. Now, we'll speak about the articular surface of the patella. If we look at this picture, this is a front view of the patella, and this is a back view. On the posterior surface of the patella, we are going to see an articular surface which articulates with the femoral condyle. So this is the posterior surface of the patella. It articulates with the front of the femoral condyle. The articular surface of the tibia. The upper surface of the medial condyle, this one, is large and oval, and it has an anteroposterior diameter which is larger than the transverse diameter. The upper articular surface of the lateral condyle is small and circular. So the upper articular surface of the medial condyle is large and oval, and it has a long anteroposterior diameter than the transverse diameter. The upper articular surface of the lateral condyle is small and circular. The two articular surfaces are separated by an area in the middle. This area is called non-articular intercondylar area. Again, it's called non-articular intercondylar area. If we look at this picture, we see the medial condyle, the lateral condyle. The medial condyle is large and oval. The lateral condyle is small and circular. The anteroposterior diameter of the medial condyle is larger than the transverse diameter. This area, it is called non-articular intercondylar area. Now, we are going to speak about the capsule of the knee joint. The fibrous capsule of the knee joint is thin. It has several attachments. First, anteriorly. The capsule of the knee joint is deficient anteriorly. Deficient means it's not present, but it is replaced by other structures. These structures are arranged from above downwards. The first one is the tendon of quadriceps muscle with what is called suprapatellar bursa. So this is the tendon of the quadriceps muscle. This is the tendon of the quadriceps muscle. Then we have the patella marked by the blue arrow. The patellar ligament. And finally, the medial and lateral patellar retinacula, which are these parts. They are found, or they are parts of the medial and lateral vastae muscles. So again, the capsule is deficient anteriorly. It is replaced from above downwards by the tendon of the quadriceps muscle, by the patella, by the patellar ligament, which is called ligamentum patelli, and lastly by the medial and lateral patellar retinaculum. This picture shows the quadriceps tendon, which is cut. It shows the patella. It shows the ligamentum patelli, and here this one is the medial patellar retinaculum, and this is the lateral patellar retinaculum. Here also you can see the lateral patellar retinaculum and the medial patellar retinaculum. Medially, the capsule is attached to the femoral and tibial condyles above or outside the margin of the articular surface, as you can see here, this one and this one. So the capsule is attached to the medial condyles of the femur and tibia outside the margin of the articular surface. Laterally, it is also attached to the femoral and tibial condyles above the articular margin. But the groove for the popliteus muscle is intracapsular, which means it is inside the capsule. This is the popliteus muscle marked by the red arrow. So the groove for the popliteus muscle, as you can see here, it is intracapsular. This is the femur, and it shows the groove for the popliteus muscle, and the capsule is attached here. So the groove for popliteus muscle is intracapsular. Posteriorly, The capsule is attached to the femur and tibia just outside the articular surface of both condyles. So this is the two condyles of the femur, and here these are the two condyles of the tibia. As you can see, the capsule is attached outside the articular surface of the femur and the tibia. It also is attached to the intercondylar line. This is the intercondylar line marked by the black arrow, by this black arrow. And it is also attached to the head of the fibula. It is attached to the head of the fibula. So posteriorly, the capsule, as we see here, it is attached to the femur and tibia outside the articular surface. It is attached to the intercondylar line, and also it is attached to the head of the fibula. By this, we finished the attachments of the capsule anteriorly, medially, laterally, and posteriorly. What about the ligaments? We have extracapsular ligaments and we have intracapsular ligaments. The extracapsular ligaments include the ligamentum patelli or the patellar ligament anteriorly, the tibial collateral ligament medially, the fibular collateral ligament laterally, and the oblique popliteal ligament posteriorly. So I have four ligaments. Anterior is the patellar ligament, medially is the tibial collateral, laterally is the fibular collateral ligament, and posteriorly is the oblique popliteal ligament. Let's begin with the patellar ligament. It is attached proximally to the apex and the rough area of the posterior surface of the patella. So it is attached here to the apex and the rough posterior surface of the patella proximally. Distally, it is attached to the upper smooth part of the tibial tuberosity. Again, the ligamentum patelli is attached superiorly to the apex and rough area of the posterior surface of the patella. Distally, it is attached to the upper smooth part of the tibial tuberosity. Take care that deep to the upper part of the patellar ligament. This is the patellar ligament. Deep to its upper part, I have what is called infrapatellar fat. So this is the infrapatellar pad of fat. This infrapatellar pad of fat is covered by an infrapatellar fold of synovial membrane. This is the infrapatellar fold of synovial membrane. Okay, now deep to the ligamentum patelli here, I have what is called deep infrapatellar bursa. This is the deep infrapatellar bursa. If we look at this slide, you can see the infrapatellar pad of fat. Infrapatellar pad of fat. Here also, this is the infrapatellar pad of fat. It lies deep to the upper part of the patellar ligament. While deep to the lower part of the patellar ligament, I can see the deep infrapatellar bursa. This is the deep infrapatellar bursa. Okay? The second extracapsular ligament is the tibial collateral ligament. This ligament is attached upwards to the medial epicondyle of the femur. Here it is attached to the medial epicondyle of the femur. Downwards, it is attached to the medial meniscus, marked by the red arrow. And it is also attached to the medial surface of the tibia, here behind the three muscles, gracilis, sartorius, and semitendinosus. This is the gracilis, sartorius, and semitendinosus muscle, the SGS. So again, the attachment of the tibial collateral ligament, upwards attached to the medial epicondyle of the femur, downwards it is attached to the medial meniscus and the upper part of the medial surface of the tibia. The third extracapsular ligament is the fibular collateral ligament. It is attached upwards to the lateral epicondyle of the femur. Here, lateral epicondyle of the femur. Downwards, it is attached to the head of the fibula in front of its apex. And it is separated from the lateral meniscus, marked by the red arrow, by the tendon of popliteus, marked by the blue arrow. So, again, upwards, it is attached to the lateral epicondyle of the femur. Downwards, it is attached to the head of the fibula in front of its apex. It is separated from it. It is separated from the lateral meniscus by the tendon of the popliteus muscle. The last extracapsular ligament is the oblique popliteal ligament. The oblique popliteal ligament is attached downwards to the medial condyle of the tibia, and it is continuous with the tendon of the semimembranosus muscle. So downwards, it is attached to the medial condyle of the tibia, and it is continuous with the tendon of the semimembranosus muscle. Upwards, it is attached to the lateral part of the intercondylar line and to the lateral condyle of the femur. Upwards, it is attached to the lateral part of the intercondylar line and to the lateral condyle of the femur. By this, we finished the four extracapsular ligaments, the patellar ligament or ligamentum patelli, the tibial collateral ligament, the fibular collateral ligament, and the oblique popliteal ligament. This picture shows three of the four extracapsular ligaments, the fibular collateral ligament, the tibial collateral ligament, and the oblique popliteal ligament. Now, we are going to speak about the intracapsular structures. The intracapsular structures are either paired structures or non-paired structures. The paired intracapsular structures are the medial and lateral menisci and the anterior and posterior cruciate ligaments. The non-paired intra-articular structures are the tendon of popliteus muscle and the infrapatellar pad of foot. If we look at this picture, we are going to see the paired structures, the medial and lateral menisci, the anterior and posterior cruciate ligaments. Now we will begin with the first paired intracapsular structures, which are the medial and lateral menisci. Each meniscus, as we see in the picture, is formed of a semilunar plate of fibrocartilage, which lies over the upper articular surface of the corresponding condyle of the tibia. These are the tibial condyles. Each meniscus has two horns, anterior and posterior, marked by the red arrows. These horns are attached to the intercondylar area of the tibia. Each meniscus has two surfaces, an upper and lower surfaces. The upper is concave or femoral surface, and the lower is flat tibial surface. So the two surfaces are upper concave femoral surface and lower flat tibial surface. Each meniscus has two borders, inner thin border marked by the blue arrow and outer attached thick border marked by the black arrow. The outer part of each meniscus is supplied by arteries, but its inner part is avascular. So, tears mostly occurs in the inner avascular part. This picture also shows the two menisci lying on the upper surface, upper articular surface of the tibia. It also shows the horns, which are attached to the intercondylar area. It shows the upper concave surface of the upper concave femoral surface, and the lower surface is flat. This picture also shows the two menisci. It shows the inner thin. It shows the inner thin border, and it shows the outer thick border of the menisci. What are the functions of the menisci? The menisci deepen the articular surfaces of the tibial condyles to adapt the curvatures of the femoral condyles. So this is the first function. They also facilitate the lubrication of the articular surfaces with the synovial fluid. They act as shock absorbers. Also, they move with the tibia in flexion and extension of the knee. And they move with the femur in rotatory movements. So they facilitate these movements. If you look at this picture, you can see two ligaments arising from the posterior margin of the lateral meniscus. This is the lateral meniscus. These two ligaments are marked by the blue arrows. They are the anterior meniscofemoral ligament and the posterior meniscofemoral ligament. This is a higher magnification of the previous picture to show the anterior and posterior meniscofemoral ligaments. This picture also shows the posterior meniscofemoral ligament marked by the red arrow. Now let's have a comparison between medial and lateral menisci. The medial meniscus is C-shaped. It is semicircular, while the lateral meniscus is circular. The two horns of the medial meniscus are wide apart. The two horns of the lateral meniscus are close together. The anterior horn of the medial meniscus is attached to the intercondylar, to the tibial intercondylar area in front of the anterior cruciate ligament, while the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus is attached to the tibial intercondylar area behind the anterior cruciate ligament. So one is in front of the anterior cruciate, which is the medial meniscus. The other is behind the anterior cruciate, which is the lateral meniscus. The posterior horn of the medial meniscus is attached to the intercondylar area in front of the posterior cruciate ligament, while the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus is attached to the intercondylar area in front of the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. What about the mobility of the menisci? The medial meniscus is more fixed as it is attached to the capsule and the tibial collateral ligament. That's why it is more liable to injury. However, the lateral meniscus is more mobile as it is separated from the capsule by the tendon of popliteus. So it is less liable to injury. This picture shows that the medial meniscus is C-shaped, while the lateral meniscus is circular. It shows that the two horns of the medial meniscus are wide apart, while the two horns of the lateral meniscus are close together. The anterior horn of the medial meniscus, this one, is attached anterior to the anterior crochet ligament. This is the anterior crochet ligament, while the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus is attached posterior to the anterior crochet ligament. The posterior horn of the medial meniscus is attached anterior to the posterior crochet ligament. This is the posterior crochet ligament, while the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus is attached anterior to the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. By this, we come to the end of this lecture. We will continue in the next lecture. Thank you.